Okay, there we go.
Hey there, YouTube, this is Vargas SX78, doing my first ever crossover with my brother, Viz69. As you can see, we're wearing Spider-Man things because, since this is our first crossover, I thought we should talk about something that we both feel strongly about, and that's Spider-Man. As you all know, Spider-Man and Dr. Octopus went through this thing where Dr. Octopus was able to switch the minds of Peter Parker and Otto Octavius and switch bodies. So Peter Parker was dying in Dr. Octopus's body, and Dr. Octopus was running around as Peter Parker. Now, I'm a big comic book collector. I'm a big comic book fan. And so I'm a fan of Spider-Man because of that. And my brother, he's a wicked fiend using Spider-Man in any of the Marvel versus Capcom games. He will beat me down with Spider-Man. So I think he's a bigger Spider-Man fan than I am. I like more Batman and Wolverine, but I like Spider-Man. But he really likes Spider-Man a lot more. So we wanted to make this video. Again, a lot of people have already talked about the controversy regarding Dan Slott's decision to do this. But I wanted to give my opinion, but also have the opinion of my brother, who's also a big Spider-Man fan, and see what he thinks. Because he doesn't collect comic books, he knows about this because I told him about it, and he read the book. So I wanted to share with everyone the thoughts of someone that doesn't collect comic books, but is a big fan of Spider-Man. So yeah, that's why I got here. And actually, if anyone knows about my videos, I like to, share their lantern rings. I actually thought he was going to rage on this video at big rant, but he said no, he read the comic book, so he seems to be okay with it. So, he's going to be the blue one for Hope. He's hoping this is a good change. And I'm going to be the indigo one for Compassion, because I'm going to give my thoughts regarding this this whole thing. So, everything started, or everything concluded in Spider-Man 700. This is the big conclusion to Dan Slott's storyline, wherein Peter Parker and Dr. Octopus do the mind switch. And Peter Parker is desperately trying to get his body back, get his life back, before Dr. Octopus's body just closed up. So what do you think about this comic book?
Technically, as a Spider-Man fan, it wasn't that bad. I haven't been collecting comics, as you explained, but I ended up going liking Spider-Man from the TV show, the animated series, around the 80s?
Was
the
one no, the 90s.
No, the 90s, yeah, sorry. I was born in 89. But because of those animated series, I started like the show, and I especially like Peter Parker's personality, his optimistic style, to be, you know, to face dangers, you know, in the face of death, and still be happy about it, you know, with his quirky jokes. So this one, Spidey, well, actually Peter Parker, is still maintains his personality, even till the end. He likes trying to fight back against Dr. Octavius, and in the end, I actually like the ending of this comic book, where he makes Dr. Octavius express, you know, everything he's gone through, all of his memories, and I personally myself relate to that, because that's, you know, that's really touching for me. There's another issue of Spider-Man that I feel like where I think he goes on a time, on a different dimension because of his friend at Horizon Labs, where he actually sees Uncle Ben again. And he's like, oh, well, I want to be here, but Ben would be better, the world would be better without me. But Uncle Ben's like, no, the world needs you. Regardless of the mistakes that have happened, you know, the world needs you, because with great power comes great responsibility. And that's the message that he provided with Dr. Octavius. And that's where the hope comes from, that Dr. Octavius will be like Peter Parker, but in that process, will bring him back.
Yeah, that's actually something he's talking about last year's annual, where Brady does an experiment where he displaces things out of time as a storage method, but that the right zaps Spider-Man, and then he gets the right out of time, so no one knows who Peter Parker is, and then as he is visiting his old haunts, you know, he starts, you know, activating himself back in the timeline and everything, and that's when you know, he meets up with the Uncle Ben. That's actually a very good character issue for Peter Parker. This one, I thought it was going to end at 700 and was going to be the death of Dr. Octopus, honestly. But as they were building it up, it appeared that they were really going to kill Peter Parker. And I'm like, well, that might be mirroring what happened in the Ultimate Universe, where Peter Parker died battling the Green Goblin. And then it was going to be this whole thing. I also liked this idea. Because honestly, the way that Peter Parker, Dan Slott fixed it, and a lot of the Spider-Man brain trust fixed it after the whole stupid deal with Mephisto.
Let's not get started with that one.
Yeah, that whole thing just really. Yeah.
Even in Ultimate Marvel's Capcom, they referenced that. You kind of look like the guy who won the marriage.
Yeah, because that was stupid. But they've been fixing Spider-Man. But one of the problems I've been having with Spider-Man, and a lot of people I think have the same problem with, is that Peter Parker seems to only he's a very responsible guy, but only about his guilt. If he messed up, my guilt makes up, it's only about him. Which is one of the things I didn't like about the deal with Mephisto, because, you know, it's not the first time Aunt May has been close to dying, so, you know, be happy with your wife. But that's a decision by Marvel, whatever. So this one I thought was interesting, what they were going for, which is why I'm wearing the indigo ring. Because I understand what Dan Slott was going for. He was going to get rid of Peter Parker, and he was going to try to redeem, I think that's what he was going for, he was going to try to redeem Dr. Octopus, because, and at the end of this issue, Dr. Octopus realizes that with great power comes great responsibility. So he was like, I finally see what you meant, Peter Parker. And you can die. I'm gonna take up the reins of Spider-Man. I'm gonna be better than you, but I'm still gonna be you, and I'm gonna honor your memory. Which is why I also like the ending of this.
Mm-hmm.
This was actually pretty good. But Dan Slott actually also leaves the seeds for Peter Parker's return, and we'll get to that. But what do you think of the cover?
That's very amazing. It's John Romita Jr. that does one of those Spider-Man artists, because
it's actually every Spider-Man artist. It's John Romita Jr., John Romita Sr., and Mark Bagley, and a whole bunch of mostly Mark Bagley, you can notice him on the Venoms, but you also have some Eric Larson there, some Todd McFarlane, and
Todd McFarlane?
Yeah, Todd McFarlane. This Venom is Todd McFarlane.
Huh?
This is Todd McFarlane. I think this is Eric Larson. So a lot of the old Spider-Man characters, artists, they used their Spider-Man image for the Spider-Mans here, the Venoms and the black costumes here, and all the main characters. I really like this cover. If they release this on a poster, I'd buy it, because it looks really cool.
Yeah.
Especially the Venoms here. But, so yeah, that's our thoughts on Spider-Man 700. Good issue and a good ending. I thought that if they would get rid of Peter Parker, because, you know, he's going to come back. As soon as the second Spider-Man movie comes out, they're going to bring him back. But that's what I thought they were going for, the redemption of Dr. Octopus. And then I'm going to talk about what I thought they were going to follow up on when we get to it. But so all in all, good issue?
Good issue. It's a nice word plot. Miners always take that big leap, and they know they're going into a danger zone doing such changes like this, like the DC reboot thing. Yeah, it was a big change, and nobody liked it. But give it some time, maybe good writers, hopefully, make something out of this story. They're obviously going to bring Peter Parker back. But for now, let's see what they have in store for us.
Yeah. And actually, I've been a fan of Spider-Man through a lot of things. Most notably, I've been a fan through the Clone Saga, and I follow Spider-Man through the Mephisto deal. And I'm willing to give this a chance, because, I think originally it's an interesting attempt, but what they're trying to do with Dr. Octopus, at least I think that's what they were going for, But, yeah, a lot of people hate what they've done with Spider-Man, but come on, people, this is not the first time they've tried to replace Peter Parker. The Clone Saga is a perfect example when they brought back Ben Reilly and he was going to be the new Spider-Man. And, again, when Spider-Man had to give up his identity and he created these four other identities, you know, it's not the first time this has happened to Peter Parker. So, I think this was an interesting experiment, and if they follow through, it might work. At least during the time they didn't bring back Peter Parker. But yeah, Dan Slott has gotten death threats, and all people have said that they're going to just not pick up Spider-Man because of this until they bring Peter Parker back. And I understand that, but again, Peter Parker sometimes gets on my nerves because he's all about me, 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 me. And then, you know, he doesn't grow up. And again, that's not Peter Parker's fault. It's the writers or editorial that keeps Peter Parker the way he is so that people can identify himself. But again, look, people grow up, people get married, people get jobs, and I think my favorite run is the J. Michael Straczynski run, because he made Peter a teacher, he brought back Mary Jane, made her a three-dimensional character, not just a damsel in distress. And I even like some of the stories that Dan Slott did, and when he brought back Mary Jane, and got rid of Charlie Cooper. So, yeah. All in all, good issue, good attempt, good execution. So, yeah, we both like this. And this actually follows up in the epilogue, which takes place in Amazing Spider-Man 15.1. This follows Dr. Octopus. Follows Dr. Octopus in the aftermath of him taking over Peter Parker. And this is where things start getting bad. I honestly thought that by the end of 700, Dr. Octopus was going to be like, okay, I'm a bad guy. I was a bad guy, but I'm going to redeem myself, and I'm going to be a better Dr. Otto Octavius and a better Spider-Man. I'm going to show the world that I can be better than Peter Parker by being a better superhero. I'm going to be smarter. I'm going to create more advanced things. I'm going to be a better superhero. This issue is out of the way with all of that. We start off with Dr. Octopus being
evil.
He even starts with an evil laugh, like, ah! I beat Peter Parker. Well, at least the same guy. And then, right off the bat, he goes evil, and he, starts planning how he's going to be a better Spider-Man, but out of spite, not out of inspiration. Which I thought was a fail. It's not written by Dan Slott, so I'm guessing that's why the character happened that way. But this is the issue where he designs his new costume. What do you think about the total 360 turn on Dr. Octopus?
I thought it was funny. You and I laugh at in my photo of the sense of the gun. Like, well, he went evil mode back again. But halfway through the issue, I guess if I don't remember that the last issue ended in that inspiring kind of way, not in an evil sort. So yeah, he gets back to it. He starts to go, oh yeah, I'm supposed to be a superior in a good way, not a superior out of spite.
Yeah, what do you think about the new costume?
It's a comment on him that on the first time they showed him putting on the glove. The claw he has is on the tip of his fingertip, and on the next page it's on the nail. So
the artwork wasn't very consistent on this one, but yeah, I don't know. I think that because they made the mask look the eyes are bigger, but they're also like rounder, so it looks like Dr. Octopus's goggles.
Yeah.
So I think that's what it looks like, and it looks like red and black. Which is a color scheme that Spider-Man already has, but again, because this is the darker Spider-Man,
I like those colors more. And every time I was actually in the anime series, it was a very dark blue color.
Yeah.
So black and red for me, it's pretty nice. I don't mind that.
Yeah. But yeah, this issue kind of like did away with the whole inspirational thing, and he's like, I am evil. Because he even travels to one of his old layers, and he's like, my traps. Like, oh shit, I'm Spider-Man now. And he kind of like hates Dr. Octopus because he's like, I'm going to be better than Peter Parker. I'm going to be better than Otto Octavius because Otto Octavius is dead, and I'm going to be the superior Spider-Man. But
that's when the answer gets back to it. He realizes everything he was as Dr. Octavius. He goes like, no wonder I failed.
Yeah, so this one, I don't collect as Amazing Spider-Man, but I picked it up because it's the epilogue dealing with Dr. Octopus, but it failed in the way that I thought it was going to follow up. So that was Amazing Spider-Man. And that leads us to the first issue of Superior Spider-Man. A lot of people skipped on this because they feel it's not Peter Parker. This is a betrayal! Betrayal! to the whole Spider-Man thing. And what do you think of this?
I'm good. Definitely love the cover art. The web looks like it's steel plate.
Well, it's not. Again, much like Avenging, it goes back to Doctor Fate being evil about it,
and even going as far as to almost killing a lot of the villains. The new Sinister Six that are probably won't last.
They don't last actually.
I mean, what's the funny part about this that I like? One of the robots, the living brain, he gets hit by all the Sinister Six powers, and he goes like, "Why was I programmed to feel pain?"
Yeah, that's funny too. I don't know. I think this is kind of again, it forgot the inspiration. At least maybe I read it wrong or I interpreted it wrong, because I thought the ending of Spider-Man 700 was inspirational to Dr. Octopus.
Mm-hmm.
And this one, Dr. Octopus is a fell down on the way, and he's a jerk. He thinks he's the bee's knees, and because he's at the horizon, and his boss like, oh, Spider-Man, I'm just thinking, you're actually creating weapons of mass destruction here. I have concerns. And Octopus like, shut up,
please. Speech, please.
I'm creating weapons, but here's the safe uses for my weapons. And he's like, oh, holy shit, you're right. Dr. Octopus is like, ha ha ha, I am superior to this inferior intellect. So like, okay, and then he's with Mary Jane, and he's like, ah, this woman's a liability. And then he looks at her boobs and says, oh yeah, that's right. One shot. I don't see her around. And he starts drinking, and even Mary Jane's like, you're drinking? Like, well, wait, no, we should celebrate. And
that family says that, and so he's like,
yeah. Yeah, the artwork on this one I thought was better. Ryan Stegman does the artwork. I thought it was a good artist. And but when he's in Spider-Man and he first encounters the Sinister Six, he's like fighting with them, and then he's like, you know what? Screw this.
Sweet.
Later, he goes away. But then he sees one of the a cop about to be hurt, and then he like swings down and saves the guy. He's like, why did I do that? Well, and then when he's with someone else, he sees a I think it was a purse snatcher.
No, that was on the other issue.
Oh, Amazing Spider-Man. And then he sees someone stealing something, and he's like, and I must have done that out of instinct. So you already see something that's going to happen at the end of this, which is why I mentioned the dance slot left the seats for it. But then he's with Mary Jane, and Mary Jane's like, aren't you going to stop the Sinister Six? Isn't that like your thing? And the reason why he has the claw things is because he scratches someone on the chest, and he injected them with nanites that are able to track the bad guys down and hear what they're saying. And Dr. Octopus is like, yeah, don't worry, I got this. And then he actually prepares to fight them again, because he figures out that they're going to make a hit on Horizon. So all the little gadgets that he did, he made a frictionless like goo, so that when the guy that runs like the Flash would not be able to cause friction, he would speed him, and he would like, oh yeah, it's okay. And then he replaced the light bulbs with these power dampening things, so that all the bad guys would lose his power. So right there, Dr. Octopus showed that at least he's better at thinking than Peter Parker, because he actually prepared for this kind of thing. So at least that, I like that he was better prepared. I think they're turning him into, like, Batman. Like, oh, yeah, I have the wits and unlimited resources, so I'm going to prepare for everything.
Thanks.
And the search of Spider-Man. So I like that. I like that. But what I didn't like is, again, the way that Dr. Octopus came out. It came out in this one in Avenging Spider-Man, like a jerk. Like, yeah, because the other thing that happens is that he gets pissed off, because he's inventing all these new things, but the credit is going to go to Peter Parker. and not Otto Octavius. And he's like, yeah, oh, I want the credit. Me. And he's like, oh, wait, no, I'm Peter Parker now. I guess I'll deal with it. okay, fine, whatever. Which is kind of stupid, because he'd be like, well, yes, I don't know, if I was Dr. Octopus, I'd be like, yes, I invented this, but basing myself on the research of Otto Octavius. Which I guess he wouldn't do, because then people would be like, wait a minute. okay, I guess that makes sense.
Yeah.
So, what do you think of the Dr. Octopus Spider-Man?
Considering that these are the first issues, probably why a lot of writers have this, like, mixed thoughts when he should be, like, a good kind of evil, or I guess it would be called anti-hero, or just plan out being a jerk or a douche. Obviously, first issue is going to be like that, because it's still all out serious right now, as he is, that he's still a bad guy, deep inside. But slowly in, the actions of Spider-Man being a hero, his responsibility, will start to kick in all of his, which is what he wants, redeeming himself. So first issue, he's going to be a douche. But later on, he's going to, well, I hope they make that way. Later on, he's going to start getting some manners, getting his good side out, redeeming himself.
Yeah, and what I was mentioning that I would hope would happen is that Dr. Octopus would redeem himself. And that he would, again, learn the phrase, with great power comes great responsibility, and he would try to be a good guy. This one shows him as a jerk right off the bat, which I don't like. Then what I thought would happen down the line is that, okay, I'm a good guy, and something would happen that would kind of, like, break him, and, I don't know, the Green Goblin comes back, and he's looking for revenge, and he would, like, go after Peter Parker, and Dr. Octopus is like, oh, I can't deal with this! What? And he goes evil again. And that's when Peter Parker could be brought back. Like, okay, Dr. Octopus is like causing chaos, like, blah, blah, blah. And that's when Peter Parker comes back. All that, boom, kicked to the curb, because by the last page of this, Dr. Octopus is beating the hell out of this bad guy. He's like, blah, blah, and all of a sudden he stops. He's like, why did I stop myself? I wanted to kill this guy. And then you see the ghost of Peter Parker, like, holding his hand, and Peter Parker's like, oh, I know you can't hear me, and I know you can't see me, but I can still, like, you know, stop you, and my name's Peter Parker, I'm still in this game, and I'm gonna come back. And I think they jumped the gun in that. That's the kind of reveal that they should have left for, like, issue 6, not the very first issue. I guess they did it to make fans aware that Peter Parker's still around somehow, so to avoid people trying to go after Dan Slott and killing him.
Get him to show up.
Yeah. So, like, no, don't kill me! Peter Parker's still in this! Just he's a ghost. And he asks, you know, he can stop Dr. Octopus from being evil. And, but yeah, I think they could drag that out. It's my same problem with X-Men First Class, that Magneto turns evil at the end of the movie, and then they cripple a kid like that. That could have been something that they could have kept for the second movie. Like, Magneto's like, yes, I will do whatever's necessary, but I'm with you, Xavier. And the kid was like, okay, cool, let's jog. But by the end of First Class, Magneto's evil, and Xavier's crippled, so they kind of, like, jumped the gun on that one, and it's the same thing that happened here.
Yeah, I agree to me. It's like, oh, that's too sudden. And technically, at least to me, to my logic sense, is that they swap brains, but you can't really block someone's memory cell. You just, like, corner them into, like, a room, right, as you take over. But eventually, that door is going to come open and Peter Parker's going to come back. You didn't need it to put a ghost, but, well, either soul or memory is going to swap back Peter Parker again. So that was a bit unnecessary for me.
And the other thing I thought they were going to do is that they were going to be like, oh, I'm going to, Dr. Octopus is dying, I'm going to play, like, the ultimate mindfuck on Peter Parker. I'm going to make Peter Parker believe he's me. It's Peter Parker, but he believes he's Dr. Octopus. So when Dr. Octopus dies, and then Peter Parker's like, oh, I'm Dr. Octopus, but he's really Peter Parker, but he's, like, being kind of, like, mind-controlled. I thought they would do that, but that theory went out the door when the ghost of Peter Parker appeared at the end of this issue, so, yeah. Again, I think it's an interesting idea. The execution is not what I would have liked, but I'm not going to give up on Spider-Man because he's going to come back. Peter Parker in his back, he's like a ghost. And so yeah, what are your final thoughts on the whole debacle?
Yeah, again, I can understand why people are rage about, especially if people who are passionate about the character. So I don't think it's much about Spider-Man being someone else. It's about Peter Parker not being there anymore. I myself will miss Peter Parker. Is like,
you're not gonna miss him. He's still here.
Well, that's like his usual jokes and silly. That's what I like about Spider-Man. His funny side, because every time I read an issue, he cracks a joke, I laugh.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna move that about reading issues about Spider-Man that my brother usually buys. I always sneak in and read them, but I'm gonna miss that. But you know, every writer makes a leak like that, so they'll give it a try. They will bring back Spider-Man eventually, but for now, let's give it some hope.
I feel for the writers, because honestly, what else can you do with Peter Parker after
700 issues?
Almost 700 issues of stories. Like, there's really nothing that you can do with Peter Parker anymore. They got him married, they broke him up, they killed his girlfriend, they only killed him, Stacy. Yeah. And he was married, he was gonna move away, he was gonna have a kid, his kid disappeared. He went crazy for a while. Really, what more can you write about the character? And this is something new. This is something that, if done right, could be real cool until Peter Parker comes back. The other thing I heard another YouTuber talk about was that what might happen is that Dr. Octopus is going to be like frustrated with the whole Peter Parker thing and not getting his due, and then he's going to like destroy Peter Parker's life. He's going to be like, he's going to get him fired from Horizon. He's going to make Mary Jane hate him, and stuff like that. So when Peter comes back, he's going to try to have to fix things, but then he's going to be back where he was with nothing, no cool job.